Thank you very much.
I will continue from the yesterday, but the talk will be sort of independent, because yesterday I was just saying general things about Hyperkahler manifold, and today I will be very particular about what I need from a Hyperkahler manifold. So today I will speak of rational curves. But the definition is the same, so Hyperkahler manifold is compact, holomorphically symplectic, Kahler type. And then we have this extra definition, which is maximal holonomy. Or IHS, irreducible holomorphically symplectic, if P1 of M is trivial and H20 of M, which is a group where you have the symplectic, holomorphic symplectic form, is C. And this is a standing assumption. I will, so this is assumed. And to justify this assumption, I will cite the Bogomolov theorem, which I explained sort of last time, that any Hyperkahler manifold is a, after taking a finite cover, becomes this guy, maximal holonomy and product of tori. Well, product of maximal holonomy and a torus. So this is harmless assumption for most purposes. Okay. There's one more piece of important topological nature, which I did not tell yesterday, and it's always something which is almost always needed. And the point is that there is a certain intersection form on second cohomology, but it makes sense only under this assumption of maximal holonomy. And it is the following. So consider the following polynomial. It's a polynomial from H2 of M. It's a polynomial function, so it goes to, if you have coefficients, say Q, to, it goes to Q. And it takes a form eta and puts it into integral over M of eta power 2n, where n, 2n is complex dimension of M. And the theorem of Fujiki tells us that P of eta is some constant times a quadratic polynomial power n. It's not hard to see why this is so, because your complex structure gives you Hodge decomposition on second cohomology. But this second this decomposition is induced by rotation, this Hodge rotation, which gives you an automorphism of cohomology ring. And then you have many such automorphisms because the deformation space is big. And then this means that this polynomial has huge symmetry. And there is no, I mean, you can check that there are no polynomials with quadratic with this kind of big symmetry group. And then this must be a power of quadratic polynomial, and this is what Fujiki theorem tells us. However, you can write, so this already defines this form Q, but you can write it down explicitly, which is also quite useful, because then it gives you, well, this is almost uniquely determines Q, except a sign. The sign is not unique because, well, it is also unique for n odd, but for n even, you can flip the sign and the formula would remain the same. So you have to fix the sign, and for that you write this huge big integral, which I'm not going to reproduce on the blackboard because I'm not going to use it anyway, except that, so let me write definition. A Q. So we choose Q in this formula, which is primitive and integer. So to make it integer, you just multiply it by a number. And if you primitive means that it is not divisible by any other integer, obviously such a Q would exist up to a sign, and the sign is fixed by that. But then a Q is called Bogomolov-Beauville-Fujiki form. This constant C here, it is a complicated constant. If you look at the examples of Hyperkahler manifolds, it's some big rational number without it's big denominator, big and unpleasant. But the form is okay. You can write down it explicitly for known examples, and it's not complicated form, except this strange number. And what is another good thing about this form is that a Q has same type as first you can choose a Hodge-Riemann pairing. Type, I mean signature, and primitive and decomposition. Well, I will explain what it is. Hodge-Riemann pairing, which takes eta prime, and put it into integral, eta which eta prime, which omega power 2n minus 2, where omega is Kahler form. This is standard pairing on a cohomology of a Kahler manifold, and it has the same signature as for surface, same properties as Poincaré pairing. Or surface. So intuition is the same, and what do I mean by that is the following, that Q of restricted to the two-dimensional space generated by the symplectic forms, omega I, omega j, and omega k. There are three symplectic forms associated with three quaternary structures, or you can write this is the same as just space generated by your Kahler form, and real part of the holomorphic symplectic form, and imaginary part of the holomorphic symplectic form. Here it is positive. And then you can consider the space of primitive forms. So H11 primitive is the set of all eta of type 11, such that eta multiplied by omega 2n minus 1 is 0. And on this space, H11 primitive, Q is negative. Negative definite. This is what I mean saying that it is very similar to Hodge-Riemann and to pairing on the Poincaré pairing. This is just essentially the Hodge index formula. So Hodge index formula is satisfied for this pairing and second cohomology, just it is as it is satisfied for the surface.
Okay.
Now I can state the result I'm going to prove mostly next time, but parts of it I will prove today. So definition. Well, I did it yesterday as well. So faces of a Kahler cone is a flat. So it's open subset of you take the boundary of the Kahler cone of its closure without the Kahler cone. So it's open subset of this boundary, which belongs to hyperplane. I mean, Kahler cone is partially round. There are some round pieces of the boundary, and there are some pieces of the boundary which are flat. So each of these flat pieces is called faces. And what I'm going to prove at some point that there are faces, there are finite. So automorphism group acts with finitely many orbits. Many orbits on faces of the Kahler cone. Okay, and for today I will explain what is, what is this faces? It turns out that the faces correspond to rational curves, to some special type of rational curves, which we call MBM curves, yes. It is usually infinite because your automorphism group is usually infinite. And it maps face to a face, and typically it acts almost freely on the boundary. Well, with finite stabilizers, possibly. Okay. So it turns out that the faces are correspond to certain cohomology classes, which are in turn correspond to minimal rational curves. So this is what I'm going to explain. For a face, yeah. No, there are infinitely many orbits. The group is infinite. The number of orbits is infinite. Oh, sorry. There are finitely many orbits, but each orbit is infinite. Yeah. So it's there is nothing which stabilizes a given orbit.
Okay. Thank you.
Now let me before I'm going to definition to more. Complicated things, let me give you the algebraic version of what I'm going to tell. And for algebraic version is actually simpler because you can state and prove explicitly what happens. So, and it is what is called the base is Kawamata base point field theorem. I'm not going to state it for more generality than I need, and I need it only for Calabi-Yau. So, let me probably give a definition. L bundle is called NEF if C1 of L belongs to the bound, to the closure of a Keller cone, and it's called big if C1 of L to the top power, which is in our case 2n, is positive. And then, so now what is base point 3? What is base point? It's also very simple. So definition, if L is a line bundle, and X is a base point in our, on M, X inside M is a base point if all sections of L vanish in X. Okay, and Kawamata theorem says that, well, here it is not even for Calabi-Yau, but for Calabi-Yau is what we need. So theorem, if L is NEF and big, then L is base point free, has no base points. No base point. This means that the corresponding map, which is a map from your manifold to predictorization of the space of sections, dual, is homomorphic. And of course, since it is big, this means that the, by Riemann-Roch theorem, the sections grow as a top power, as the dimension of the space of sections grows. As we take tensor power of L, it grows like a dimension. So it is a also birational map. So for then, you have M goes to projectivization of H0 of L, well, Ln dual is birational conduction. It's holomorphic and birational. Means that it contracts something, and of course it cannot. What it contracts is, as usual, is a union of rational curves. So the fibers of such contractions are always they're unions. They're rationally connected. So fibers are rationally and this is, now you can actually write down the boundary explicitly for this point. Sorry? Yes. Yes, it's variational to its image and holomorphic. Thank you. Okay, so now you have some L inside the boundary of the Keller cone. Without, which is not, I mean, not ample, but NEF and big. Then L vanishes on certain rational curve. Well, C1 of L. And now you can take the orthogonal complement to this rational curve. Since L square is positive, C1 of L square is positive. I mean, by square, I mean Q of C1 of L, C1 of L. Well, it's semi-positive because it sits in the Kahler cone, and it is positive because it's big. Then this implies that C square is negative. By C square here, I mean, again, the cohomology class of C, which is, of course, it's homology class, but you can use the form to identify cohomology and cohomology. So you have Q of cohomology class of C with itself is negative. It can be positive. They can be both positive because of index of Hodge index formula. Okay, so you have, then you can take the whole orthogonal hyperplane to this class. And it cuts the positive cone into two pieces. Okay, so instead of having just one nerve bundle, which is not, which sits on the boundary, you have a whole wall on the Kahler cone, which sits on the boundary, just this orthogonal complement. This explains how you get these pleiadal pieces. So each time you have a boundary of your Kahler cone, a piece of the boundary which is a face, which is flat, this corresponds to certain contraction, and it is one-to-one correspondence. Okay, so now my aim is to describe these constructions, possibly in topological terms. I mean, not the contractions, but the classes which give these contractions. Now, before I do that, let me give you a couple more things about Hyperkahler geometry. So this is something about the moduli spaces and the corresponding group. The problem is that there are no moduli spaces. If you, of course, you can, if you fix the polarization, if you fix the Kahler metric, there are. But if you don't, it's sort of pointless to speak of moduli spaces because there's no points essentially. So there are so much non-Hausdorff that it is not a variety at all. So it's topology of the what you could think of the moduli space. The topology is like co-discrete topology. There's almost no open set. Okay, but the good thing is that there is a Teichmuller space. So Teichmuller space is just the space of all complex structures quotient by isotopic group. This is all complex structures. And this is group, connected component of diffeomorphisms. This is space which was really used by Teichmuller for curves, but it makes sense for Hyperkahler as well. And then, of course, you have this group of diffeomorphisms quotient by this zero, which is called mapping class group. This is a discrete group, which is actually explicitly known for, denoted by gamma. And then the set of complex structures is Teichmuller space by gamma, obviously. I mean, this is essentially tautology. What is not entirely tautological is that this guy has topology. The set of all complex structures has a topology like, you put the topology just on tensors, like convergence with all derivatives, and then the quotient acquires topology as well, but not only topology. In fact, by Kuranisha theory, there are local charts. So, and they make at least for Kolobyov manifolds, they may take into a complex manifold or variety. For Kolobyov, it's manifold. And this complex manifold is actually smooth. It is smooth, but very non-Hausdorff. So it's sort of not entirely obvious how to work with it. But since it's smooth, it's workable. Okay, but the problem with the mapping class group is that its typical orbit is dense. So the quotient makes no sense. But it's actually useful as well. You can put this observation to many uses. Okay, so for me, I told this, I will use it at some point, but what is needed at the moment is the following. You have take I. Is connected component of take containing I. There are finitely many connected components, so this is not a big deal. And you can take the gamma I. It's a subgroup of gamma, preserving I take Teichmuller component. Called monotypic group. And it's called monotypic group for the following reason, that you can take, let's take a deformation of our Hyperkahler manifold, any deformation with connected base. Then, since the fibers of these deformations are identified topologically, this gives you a sort of local system on the deformation, which is called Gauss-Manion local system. And then, as you go around your deformation variety, your family of deformations, this gives you monodromy of your local system. And then this group is generated, is a group generated by all such monodromies. This is why it's called monodromy group, by all Gauss-Manion. Now I can continue with the back to the curves. Okay, but before that, I will tell you one more piece. This is what happens with, I told you this space is non-Hausdorff. It turns out that thanks to Huybrechts, you can describe this non-Hausdorff points very explicitly. And it is done as follows. So it turns out that if you have two birational Hyperkahler manifolds, they correspond to non-Hausdorff points, and converse is also true. So first, notice that if M and M prime are Kolobyov, are birational Kolobyov, then the exceptional locus of this birational correspondence, well, it is a place where it is not defined, of correspondence, is codimension bigger than one. Well, convex codimension bigger than one, real codimension bigger than three. So then this means that H2 of M is identified with H2 of M prime. So if you have two birationally equivalent Hyperkahler manifolds, they have bimeromorphically equivalent Hyperkahler manifolds, they have the same second cohomology. The second cohomology are canonically identified. And then the theorem of Huybrechts. Tells us that if M is birationally equivalent to M prime, then the corresponding points in the moduli space in Teichmuller are non-separate. And converse is also true. You should take care with this statement because to make this sense of that, you have to fix the basis in second cohomology. Otherwise, there are many points in the Teichmuller space which, I mean, the group, this monodromy group acts on the Teichmuller space, and there are many points where, I mean, you take any point and you take its orbit, and there are, of course, variations, they are even equivalent, but they are not separate because they sit on different separated, they are separated by certain distance, because the group acts. So to cancel this, you have to fix the. So this implication is always true, and this implication you have to fix basis in H2. Yes. Yeah. It doesn't actually matter. You can identify with. You don't think you can identify them with Z coefficients? I think you can. Yeah, so I means that I fix this is the cohomology of this variety and this cohomology of that variety. So when I put comma I, this means that I just pick with this particular variety. Of course, they are all identified by identification, it's not canonical. So if we want to make a choice, we have to fix the point in the Teichmuller space. Okay, thank you very much. So, we're separating them, thank you. Yes, of course, thanks. Okay. Now I can go, finally I can go to the to the curves. And there, so I told you how to, in algebraic situation, how you find a curve by, if you have a piece on the boundary of a Kahler koan. So, but in fact, there's an easier way of doing it using this Heubrechts result because it turns out that the Kahler cones are in one-to-one correspondence, different Kahler cones on the same, which has the same Hodge decomposition, are in one-to-one correspondence with non-separate points in your Teichmuller space. This is the way how they prove this beautiful result of Heubrechts and Buxom. Well, so Buxom is the original proof of Heubrechts was it was in 90s. It was wrong, and then it was fixed by both of them. Okay, it says that if you have a point on the boundary of Kahler cone, then it has to vanish on a rational. Let eta belong to a Kahler cone, to the closure, without a Kahler. So it's an F, which an F class, which is not Kahler, belongs to closure, but not the Kahler cone. But a Q of eta is positive. Then eta. Multiply, you can restrict eta to a rational curve, and it is zero for a rational curve C. Again, C square will be negative for the same reason as I told you. It's just Hodge index formula, which says that if you have two positive classes, their product is positive. So since these two guys are multiplied by zero, this means that C is negative. C square is negative. Okay. So now we want to distinguish Of course, not. There are many rational curves, and not all rational curves serve as boundaries of the Kahler quantum. So, definition at is negative. If Q of eta is zero, there is this definition of MBM class, which is quite long. I don't want to reproduce it because I'm not going to use it that much. But so the idea is that if your curve is minimal, you have a rational curve which is minimal, you can then it sits on a extremal ray in your effective cone of all curves. But the dual cone to effective cone is a Kahler cone. So then this means that this curve corresponds to a hyperplane in the dual cone. This is why minimality is needed. But you see, there's still quite complicated definition of these MBM classes because you can also have birational transform, and then you can have monodromy action on that. So MBM is all minimal. And then you act on that birational, and then you act by monodromy on that. You take minimal curve, you replace your Hyperkahler manifold by another birational model where it curves. I mean, this cohomology class stops being a class of a curve or might remain a class of curve, but the curve stops being minimal. And then you act by monodromy. This is the reason for the definition. But in fact, there is much simpler way of defining that. It will be on the next slide, but maybe I will reproduce it here and then flip the slide. Definition: let M be Hyperkahler manifold with Picard group generated by Z, where Z square Q of ZZ is negative. It's a negative class. And of course, yeah. Then it is obviously non-algebraic because, as I told you, the Kahler forms, the ample classes, they squared positively. So it's non-algebraic manifold. Then, either Z is represented, or some constant Z, by a curve. So it's effective. Or the Kahler cone of M has no abstractions. It's the same as positive cone, the cone of all positive vectors. And then it turns out that this property, so Z is, so this is called Q-effective. Z is Q-effective. Z is Q effective on MI, then Z is Q effective on all deformations of MI. And such classes are called MBM. So the algebraic geometrical definition, which I explained to you that you take minimal, you deform it, is not really needed because you have this non-algebraic definition, which is simpler. So definition, MBM class is Q effective class in H2, H1, 1, M I generating
car of MI.
And the theorem, this is independent. This notion is independent on choice of I. Okay. Now let me explain in more detail what is this positive clause. Because before I'm going to prove that. But if I have, hopefully I have time. But before I prove that, let me explain why it is useful. Well, I'm not going to prove it, but at least, well, I explain why it is useful. So, you have positive con. Of course, you have the set of all vectors eta inside H11 of MR, such that Q of eta is positive. This is a really, this is a vector space with signature 1 plus many minuses. So this is your usual con, but then you have to fix connect the components because there are two. So connected components, you fix the connected components containing Kahler class. Component containing Kahler class. Okay, and as I told you, if there are no, well, it just follows from this Heubrecht's Buxom theorem, if there are no rational curves, the positive cone is the Kahler cone. There are no other abstractions because, if you have a vector in this positive cone, which is sits on the boundary of a Kahler cone, it has to be vanish on some rational curve. If there are no rational curves, good, there are no abstractions to Kahlerness. So these abstractions are precisely these MBM classes. Okay, so now I will explain you the picture. So before I do that, also there is the connection to the hyperbolic geometry, which is already seen there. So you take the predictivization of the positive cone. And this is, of course, a hyperbolic space, because predictivization of a cone inside a space of signature 1 n is a hyperbolic space. It's canonic. It has canonical hyperbolic metric of constant curvature. And then the mapping class group, or in our case, it would be better to say it, Hodge monodomy group, acts there. And the quotient, well, you have to take the quotient is, of course, hyperbolic. And if you take the smallest subspace, which is generated by rational, so it's like Picard part of that, Hodge part of that, the quotient is actually a hyperbolic manifold of finite volume. And the geometry of this manifold is interpreted in terms of, Hyperkahler geometry of the manifold M is interpreted in terms of hyperbolic geometry of this quotient. This is where hyperbolic geometry appears first time.
Okay. So,
now, there's this theorem that I sort of explained to you how to prove it. So I won't have time to explain more. So it says that if you have a non-algebraic hyperkahler manifold with Picard generated by negative homology class, then it is monodomy birationally minimal if and only if it is plus minus Z is Q-effective. So first, if you have negative rational curve, it represents an MBM class. Because, it's one-dimensional. It's minimal, and there is no there could be two birational models, possibly, because there are two components of Kahler cone, but anyway, it's clearly minimal, so it's MBM. And then, if there are no rational curves, Kahler cone is everything, so and then Z is non-effective. So Z has to be and then there's just one birational model. So the Kahler cone is positive, there is just one birational model, and then this guy cannot be equivalent to anything else. I mean, there's no birational birational transforms of this particular manifold. So this means that indeed, for this degenerate case, minimality is equivalent to MBM. And then we can forget about this minimality and just use this notion, which I wrote as a definition. Okay. Now there is this result, which is proven along the way with the theorem which I am going to prove, if I have. Well, at least I will explain some parts of this proof, but it is really the same result. And it explains how the Kahler classes work. So, it is a result about what are Kahler cones of all birational models of your hyperkahler manifold. Okay, so you have M, hyperkahler, MI, say. You take H11 of M and intersect it with a set of all MBM classes. Here this guy is denoted S. So they are all integers, so this is a certain countable set. Then you take S orthogonal, which is a union of all orthogonal hyperplanes. So it's a union of all S orthogonal for all S small inside this S big. And then you take positive theorem, positive without this union of orthogonal hyperplanes is the all Kahler cones for all birational models of M up to monodromy. Okay, so what happens? Now I can give you the picture. There are two pictures, actually. This one picture is which never happens. So this is somehow, this could possibly happen because a priori, but it cannot. So this is the orthogonal. You see, if you have some bit of a boundary of a Kahler cone, it reminds about the other Kahler cones or other birational models of your manifold. So these guys, these two guys are, say, two birational models of the same manifold. They are separated by a flip. A flip means that you blow down a curve and then you blow up a curve in different direction. Or, and then there are other guys which can be obtained from this by monodromy action. Because monodromy action can actually put you somehow but they are still Kahler cones. So in a sense, everything, all chambers, these guys, the these connected components of the complement are called Kahler chambers. They are all there are some convex subsets in this cone, and they are all Kahler cones of some hyperkahler manifolds. So if you are interested in the shape of a Kahler quantity, you will see that it is very useful. You just need to determine what are your MBM classes. Okay, I think I have like 8 minutes. So you have many, so your manifold have many birational models, which are non-isomorphic. So they correspond to different shapes of Kahler cone. You see some Kahler cone have, on this picture, they have this kind of round boundaries, other don't. It's actually, well, there's a certain cheating there, but they're still different. So there are birational models, and there are many instances of same birational models which correspond to just monodromy action, like exchanging, I mean, the mapping class group action exchanging the models, but the models are, in fact, isomorphic. They are just, the way of looking at them are different because we applied the monodromy action. Okay. Let me explain now how you prove this. So how you prove that these MBM classes are deformational invariant? This is the main result for today, and I have like a few minutes, I can do it. So start with a minimal curve. What does it mean, a minimal curve? Well, this is a curve which can be split. You deform it, and it doesn't split. But there is the method in algebraic geometry called bend and break. If you have a set of curves passing through two given points, then there is a limit which splits. So if you have 2 points, there is a unique, well, there are finitely many minimal curves passing through these 2 points. Okay, this already gives you something, some information about the dimension of deformation space. But it's an upper bound. The lower bound is easier. It is provided by this observation of Zivran. So if you have a rational curve, C rational curve in M, the normal bundle of C is, it's dual to tangent plus of minus 2 plus of 1, plus O when power n. But anyway, so this gives you dimension. You have the degree of normal bundle is minus 2. And then the rank of its deformation of its 2n minus 1. So the deformation is the space, its dimension is at least 2n minus 2. So deformation of C, dimension of this space, is at least 2n minus 2, minus 3. In fact, it's 2n minus 2, because there is this notion called twisted deformation, which I told you last time. This is quaternion rotation. And the good thing about twisted deformation is that general fiber has nothing, no curves, no divisors, nothing, no algebraic geometrical interesting things. And then since you can consider this curve inside this twister family, it adds you extra dimension. But in the fibers, this actually becomes 2n minus 2. So this is the lower bound on dimension of the curve. So the deformation of the curve has dimension at least 2n minus 2. So extra dimension comes from this. And the rest of dimension is just standard deformation theory, which says that you can express deformation space in terms of degree. Okay. Now there is another result which shouldn't be very surprising, at least in view of rational connected theory of rational connected varieties. It says that the union of all deformations of a minimal curve is coisotropic. Just any rational curve, in fact. So to see it, coisotropic means that its tangent space, if you take its dual, it will be isotropic space. Namely, so it's the rank of the Kahler of holomorphic symplectic form on the tangent space is minimal possible. And so the idea is that your fibers, so you can project your union of the curves, do the what is called MRC projection, which is just you take, you blow down all rational curves, essentially. It's minimal rational connected quotient to some V. And this V is, you can easily see that it is like locally holomorphically symplectic, and the fibers are orthogonal, so you count dimension, you find that it's coisotropic. And from this coisotropicity, you obtain the bound on the upper bound, which is the same as lower bound. So this means that if you have a minimal rational curve on a holomorphic symplectic manifold, it deforms into n minus 2 dimensional family. Okay. Now, how you use that? It's very easy. So if you have a deformation of a manifold and your curve remains of type 1-1, then it just deforms in that direction with the same. To see that, you just count the, again, you count the dimension as previously, is in the RAM theorem. So you add an extra dimension for twisters, which you know you cannot deform, and then you deform it in that dimension, in that direction, just because it's in like extra. You added extra dimension for the deformation of the base, so your curve has to deform just by this dimension count. Okay. And so now you can, you take the Teichmuller space of all deformations of your manifold such that this class, the cohomology class of your curve, remains of type 1-1. This is called Teichmuller Teich. It's a divisor inside Teichmuller space. So it's all I such that Z is type H, is type 1-1 with respect to I. This is codimension one subvariety, and it also has this kind of twister type. In effect, it's very similar to the usual Teichmuller space for Hyperkahler manifold. And what we know from what I told you is that if you have a curve, I mean, the limit of a curve is again a curve, of course. So you, if you start with a point, you go along this Teichmuller Z, you can cover, come to any other point with this curve. So the curve is deformed with the with a space. The only problem, and this is where MBM notion becomes important, is that, okay, we can deform it, but our space is not Hausdorff. So in the end, or somewhere else, we don't have any control over which of the non-Hausdorff point we arrive to. This is where this birational monodromy comes in. So birational monodromy means just that you have a curve which is maybe not in your variety, but in some other non-Hausdorff point in the same Teichmuller space, non-Hausdorff, non-separate point from that variety. But this is already enough for our purposes because this means that your class remains represented by a curve, in, maybe in some other variational model, and then it really remains always a wall of a Kahler cone for each deformation. This is this deformation invariance of MBM classes. Thank you very much. I think I'm done.